morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us.
No, I think we're live now.
Yes, no.
Try that again. Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us at St. Saviour's Anglican Church in Winnipeg, because we know that many are watching from outside of here, so welcome. Please thank you for joining us on Epiphany 3, the service of the Word. This is where we acknowledge any birthdays and special events, and we're aware of a couple of birthdays. Mary Corrid, turning 90 years old, I believe, and Janet Andrews, not quite 90, but happy birthdays to both of them. And we offer the blessing.
May the blessing of the Lord be upon you. We bless you in the name of the Lord. May the blessing of the Lord be upon you. We bless you in the name of the Lord.
Our opening hymn is 306, Oh for a Thousand Tongues to Sing. You shine with God's love and illumine the whole universe. Blessed are you, Son of Mary, born a child, you shared our humanity.
Let heaven and earth shout their praise.
Blessed are you, Son of David, born to rule. You received gifts from the wise men. Blessed are you, Son of Man, baptized by John. You saved us from ourselves. Blessed are you, Heavenly King, teaching and preaching, healing and comforting. You proclaim the kingdom.
Let heaven and earth shout their praise.
With all the voices of heaven, we celebrate. The Lord will come, let us worship. Please be seated for the proclamation of the word.
The psalm appointed for the day is Psalms 19. And the refrain is, the word of the Lord, our spirit and life. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament shows the handiwork of the Lord. One day tells its tale to another, and one night imparts knowledge to another.
The word of the Lord, our spirit and life.
Although they have no words or language, and their voice are not heard, the song has gone out into all lands, and their message the ends of the world.
The word of the Lord, our spirit and life.
In the deep as God sent a pavilion for the sun. It comes forth like a bridegroom out of his chamber. It rejoices like a champion to run its course. It goes forth from the utmost edge of the heavens and run about to the ends of it again. Nothing is hidden from its burning heat.
The words of the Lord are spirit and life.
The law of the Lord is perfect and revives the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure and gives wisdom to the innocent. The statutes of the Lord are just and rejoice in heart. The commandments of the Lord is clear and gives light to the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clear and endures forever. The judgment of the Lord are true and righteous altogether.
The words of the Lord are spirit and life.
More to be desired are they than gold, more than much fine gold. Sweeter far than honey in the comb. By them also is your servant enlightened, and in keeping them there is great reward.
The words of the Lord are spirit and life.
Who can tell how often they offend? Cleanse me from my secret faults. Above all, keep your servant from presumptuousness, sin. Let them not get dominion over me, then shall I be whole and sound and innocent of great offense. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be accepted in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer.
The words of the Lord are spirit and life.
And we continue in worship with a song that you won't find in the hymn book. It's called Thy Word. And please enjoy the beautiful lyrics of this song.
He read from it, facing the square before the water gate. from early morning until midday in the presence of the men and the women and those who could understand. And the ears of all the people were attentive to the book of the law. And Ezra opened the book in the sight of all the people, or was standing above the people. And when he opened it, all the people stood up. Then Ezra blessed them, the Lord, the great God, and all the people answered, Amen, Amen, lifting up their hands. Then they bowed their head and worshiped the Lord with all their faces to the ground. So they read from the book, from the law of God, with interpretation. They gave the sense so that the people understood the reading. Now Nehemiah, who was the governor, and Ezra the priest and scribe, and all the Levites who taught the people, said to the people, This day is holy to the Lord your God. Do not mourn or weep, for all the people wept when they heard the word of the law. Then he said to them, Go your way, eat the fat, drink the sweet wine, and send portions of them to those for whom nothing is prepared. For this day is holy in our Lord, and do not be grieved, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the first letter of Paul to the Corinthians. For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in the one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and we were all made to drink of one Spirit. Indeed, the body does not consist of one member, but of many. If the foot were to say, Because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less a part of the body. And if the ear were to say, Because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less a part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the hearing be? If the whole body were hearing, where would the sense of smell be? But as it is, God arranged the members in the body, each of them as he chose. If all were a single member, where would the body be? As it is, there are many members, yet one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you, nor again the head to the feet, I have no need of you. On the contrary, the members of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable, and those members of the body that we think less honorable we clothe with greater honor, and our less respectable members are treated with greater respect, whereas our more respectable members do not need this. But God has so arranged the body, giving the greater honor to the inferior member, that there be so no dissension within the body, but the members may have the same care for one another. If one member suffers, all suffer together with it. If one member is honored, all rejoice together with it. Now you are the body of Christ and individually members of it. And God has appointed in the church first apostles, second prophets, third teachers, then deeds of power, then gifts of healing, forms of assistance, forms of leadership, various kinds of tongues. Are all apostles? Are all prophets? Are all teachers? Do all work miracles? Do all possess gifts of healing? Do all speak in tongues? Do all interpret? But strive for the greater gifts, and I will show you a still more excellent way. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Thanks be to God.
Our gradual hymn is 397, Praise the One Who Breaks the Darkness.
Praise the One who bless the children with a strong yet gentle word. Praise the one who drove out demons with a piercing two-edged sword. Praise the one who brings cool water to the desert's burning sand. From this well comes living water, quenching thirst in every land. Praise the one true love incarnate, Christ who suffered in our place. Jesus died and rose for many, that we may know God by grace. Let us sing for joy and gladness, seeing what our God has done. Praise the one redeeming glory, praise the one who makes us one.
The Lord be with you. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Then Jesus, filled with the power of the Spirit, returned to Galilee, and a report about him spread through all the surrounding country. He began to teach in their synagogues and was praised by everyone. When he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where it was written. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. And he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of all in the synagogue were fixed on him. Then he began to say to them, "Today this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." This is the gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
As noted before, in sermons, I guess, before we started to live stream, that one of the challenges of lectionary is that every third year, it repeats itself. And also that pretty much every reading overlaps to one another. So as a preacher, it becomes sometimes very difficult to preach something which has not been said before. Now, if you have been following us, in past 2 weeks, we did talk about the baptismal ministry, and we also spoke about the unity of the body of Christ. The unity celebrating the week of prayer for Christian unity, and talking about how all of us are interlinked, interconnected, and interdependent on one another. And the time has come for us to forget about our differences, or to forget about being jealous of one another, but to look at how we can continue to work for the kingdom of God. So let's start this week reflection by listening to a story which this monk told. And the monk tells us that in the monastery, there was a monastery which was extremely vibrant, and it did everything which was expected of them. And people from the nearby towns and villages came for worship, came to listen to the monks, participated in the life of the monastery, and things were going well. But in the middle of all of it, all of a sudden the people started to go away, and everything left. And when the abbot tried to understand or intervened and discerned or tried to discern what was happening, what he realized that the monks had started to bicker among themselves. What he realized that the monks were trying to gain favor over the other. What he realized that the monks were backstabbing one another and had forgotten who they were serving. And because of that, of course, because of that, everything changed, because people saw the bigotry and also were disgusted, to say the least, to see the actions of the monks. Now one day, Abbot decided that he will have a seminar. So he had a seminar. It lasted for a day. The peace among the monks lasted for 2 hours, and back they were to their old ways. And finally, after trying several things, the abbot decided that he will leave the monastery and will come back when it will be good for him to come back, or when he will have an answer to the problem which they were facing. As he walked into the forest, he came across a saint, a hermit, who was living in the wilderness by himself. The abbot approached him and asked him if he could join, and the hermit motioned to him to sit down. And for the next 7 days, they sat in silence, they ate in silence, they prayed, they listened to the sounds around them, they listened to the voice of God. And then the 7th day, the hermit opened his eyes and looked at the abbot and said, "Ask me, what shall I tell you? Why are you here with me for past 7 days? So Abbot had this whole long list of things which he explained to the hermit. And the hermit said, "It's very simple. Go to your brothers and tell them that one of them is Christ among them. You don't know, they don't know, but God has sent Christ among them to live with them." Now, Abbot in his mind thought, what an interesting idea. We all know that. We all know that we are on the image of God. We all know that Christ has redeemed us. We all know that Christ works and lives through us and allows us to be his people in the world. But just to ridicule himself and to hold the word of the hermit, he went back, gathered all the brothers together, and told them, "The hermit has sent you a message through me. And the message is, one of you is Christ, living, dwelling among us. We don't know who Christ is, but one of us is Christ living among us." And the whole atmosphere changed. The whole environment changed. The monks, the abbot, everybody else started to see each other in a different light, because they were not sure who was Christ among them. And of course, as the story goes, that the monastery became a lively place. It became a place of solitude, place of prayer, place of singing, place of Eucharist. And the gathering from the towns started to happen again, as people saw that the monastery and the monks were doing what they were called to do. So the point of the story, of course, lies that whenever we are doing good, whenever we are progressing, we cannot sit back and look at it and say we have arrived, but also there are ways to destroy everything which is happening. And of all the people in the world, as this story tells us, that the monks who have taken the vows of obedience and chastity and poverty are the ones who are given, who gave into the human desire to be more important than the other, and destroyed or affected the ministry to which they were called. You see, Jesus' times tells us about the same thing. And we can move from Jesus' time to our own times, and we can see the same thing happening in our own midst. When I look back at the calendar, as most of you do, we realize that we are almost in the 25th or 26th month of COVID. Now, in North America, it arrived in the latter part of February, or in February, but it started in China and different parts of the world in almost 2019, in November, December, and then it started to travel. And I remember that in March, most of the dioceses had said that there will not be communion. Other dioceses were saying we have to stay apart. And of course, March the 15th, here, we completely shut down. And we have not come back to what we were. We had some in-person services, but Omicron and the virus and the dangers or threat around our well-being, physical well-being, has forced us to go back into what we were doing. And that is alarming. It is alarming because we can think of the survival of the church and of the society, of the businesses, of people who rely on social services, of people who give themselves to various activities in the city. But in the midst of all of that, what we have to understand is that we cannot let this take us away from the primary message which we are called to proclaim, from the primary ministry to which we are called. And as Jesus, after his baptism, right went back into his town and read the vision of Isaiah and told the people in their sight that it was fulfilled. And Jesus said, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." And of course, as Luke tells us, Jesus read from Isaiah, and then he said, "Today the scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." So what the scripture tells us, that it gives us the hope, it gives us the mandate, which nothing can take it away from us. You see, most of the times we have associated church with the buildings, with the resources. Of course, we need a place to worship. We need a place to gather. We need a place to be God's people together, communing, eating, drinking, laughing, joking, worshiping, singing, and everything else. But we also know that this gathering, or the gatherings to which we are called, has another purpose to it. And the purpose of it is to release the captives from their misery, to bring sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, and to proclaim the year of Lord's favor. Now, if we take it literally, then we have to believe in being miracle workers. But if we see it metaphorically and figuratively, then what we realize is that there are so many people who are blinded to the goodness in the world. There are so many of us who, because of real reasons, or be confined to our homes, to give up our lives, our leisure, our routines, not being able to see our family on a regular basis, children separated from their parents if they're studying away, so on and so forth, that we can give up that goodness which still exists. We can give in to the doom and gloom which is around us. And all these lines, to bring sight to the blind, release to the captives, and oppressed go free, we can be understood in our efforts to journey with others, to lessen the load, to bring new hope, to bring new vision, to continue to be faithful to God, and to continue to trust that with our efforts and God's grace, this too shall pass. As in all the storms, all the calamities, all the dangers which afflicted the world in various ways since the inception of this, since the beginning of the world, did pass. And every one of them left us more stronger than we realized at that point. Every aspect, every challenge left us more united than we realized or we thought we would be at that time. So the ministry to which we are called, of course, a big segment of it is missing. I was looking at the list of members last week, and I was surprised at how many faces I haven't seen And as I was reading the name, I could see their face and some story or some interaction attached with them. And it is like all of us. But in the midst of that, we must remember that the ministry and the work of God and the Word of God is still alive and is still working among us. And we can still do the things which God has called us to do, which in this case, repeating it, is to bring sight to the blind, to release the captives, and to let the oppressed go free. And the last line that Jesus said, which is extremely important, where he said, and to proclaim the year of Lord's favor, which is that every year, like this year, will have its ups and downs, will have its struggles and good news. We might have another peak plateau go down and then come back out of it, or we may not come out of it and we may have to see another circumstances like this. But in all of it, we have to remember that the Lord is still looking with favorable eyes at us. The Lord is still giving us a day to live, and the year of the Lord's favor is the time to sit back and continue to reflect on what God has bestowed upon us and how God is working through us. And we see that in Jesus' life, that whenever he was done, he was exhausted. He knew that the power, strength and power and grace has gone out of his life, out of his body, that he took time out to reflect, to pray, to recharge, to meditate, and to believe that through this he will be able to see the work of God and to proclaim the release to the captives, to let the oppressed go free, and sight to the blind. So think about it and pray about it. That God will give us grace to do our level best in these times in particular, all times in general, to be in communion, in relationship with one and another, to see for how God sees us, and to make sure that we are the ones who are called to this ministry. We are the ones who can continue on doing that. And at the same time, we are the ones who are also in need of someone ministering to us, someone reaching out to us, someone taking care or journeying with us. Reciprocal, in which people come together. And why do we want to do that? Because I'm comfortable, I'm a selfish note, I can say I'm comfortable in my own bubble. I'm carefully following all the rules and regulations. And if my neighbor is not doing that, well, more power to him, he can deal with it and forget about it. But if you listen to the monk or to the wisdom of this hermit, and that's what our faith tells us, that we don't know where and when and in whose body will we encounter Christ, as Christ is among us, expecting us to serve him. We don't know the identity of that person, but we do know that Christ is among us and is waiting for us to reach out to him. And that's a responsibility and obligation I'm afraid we cannot walk away from. We cannot deny, and we cannot forget in our lives, in our minds, and through our actions. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen.
And the offertory hymn is number 507, Blessed Be the Tie That Binds.
Thank you.
Flame of abundant love, be our joy in proclaiming your good news to the world.
We pray for all who are coming to faith, all who wonder about faith, and all who are struggling with faith.
Light of all creation, guide us to lead, teach, and nurture your disciples.
We pray for those in need of food, shelter, clothing, and of God's healing touch, especially those for whom our prayers are especially desired.
And this morning, on our parish prayer list, we pray for Eileen F., Bob, Gail, Debbie, Joyce, Marion B., Doreen, Ken and Sheila, John, Jeanette, Julie, Lori, Eileen L., Ernie, Paul, Tamara, Max, Mike, Doreen H., Terry, Sharon, Dan, Henrietta, Margaret, Ed, Larry and family, Bonnie M., Merlene, Krista, Megan, Barb, George and family. Comforter of the suffering, warm our hands to loving service.
We pray for the world, especially where there is trouble and suffering, far away or nearby.
Ember of steadfast care, fuel our passion to challenge injustice and violence and to pursue peace and reconciliation.
We pray for the land on which we stand, the peoples, creatures, plant life, and waters around us.
Star blaze of glory, lead us to care for this fragile earth, our island home, and to heal the circle of creation.
God of radiant light, your love illumines our hopes before we know them, and our needs before we ask. Kindle your flame within us, that in our prayers and service, we may know your transforming presence at work in the world around us. All this we ask through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And the collect of the day together.
God of all mercy, your Son proclaimed good news to the poor, release to the captives, and freedom to the oppressed. Anoint us with your Holy Spirit, so that all people may be free to praise you in Christ our Lord. Amen.
And as our Savior Jesus Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
May the Lord Jesus Christ, who walks on wounded feet, walk with you to the end of your road. May the Lord Jesus Christ, who serves with wounded hands, help you to serve one another. May the Lord Jesus Christ, who loves with a wounded heart, be your love forever. Look for the face of our Lord Jesus Christ in everyone you meet, and may they see his face in you. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you, and remain with you this day and always.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
A couple of announcements before we leave, and one big thank you, and that is that on behalf of the parish, we give our heartfelt thanks because we're so blessed that the members of our congregation and others that we don't even know through this two-year pandemic that Edmund referred to have continued to bless us with your offerings, your financial offerings. And of course, we encourage each other to continue to do that. And as Edmund said, we're also so blessed that everybody has maintained offering of themselves in many ways, not only to serve those of need in the community, but to serve each other. This service will be uploaded to YouTube later. It was a little late last week, but I have enough good account that our guy that does that will do it quicker this week. And also, if you haven't joined our online auction, it's started. I think we're in a little bit of Christmas fatigue because it hasn't taken off yet, but so have a look. Six items, lots of bargains to be had, and as I look in the parish hall, there's lots more stuff coming in and more than we're aware to come in. So the plan is to keep this going for a while. So get your auction tams or hats back on, and we'll see you. The winners are at 7 o'clock tonight. Our closing hymn is another new one that you won't find in the hymn book, but you're gonna hear it a couple of weeks in a row, and it's another lovely hymn called Christ Be Our Light.
For the world to see Christ.
longing for hope, many despair. Your word alone has power to save us, make us your living bones. Christ, be our light, shine in our hearts, shine through the darkness. Christ, be our light, shine in your church, gather today. Longing for food, many are hungry. Longing for water, many still thirst. Make us your bread, broken for others. Share until all are filled. Christ, be our light. Shine in our hearts. Shine through the darkness. Christ, be our light. Shine in your church, gathered today. Longing for shelter, many are homeless. Longing for warmth, many are cold. Make us your building, sheltering others, walls made of living stone. Christ, be our light. Shine in our hearts, shine through the darkness. Christ, be our light, shine in your church, gather today. Many the gifts, many the people, many the hearts that yearn to belong. Let us be servants to one another, signs of your kingdom come. Christ, be our light. Shine in our hearts. Shine through the darkness. Christ, be our light. Shine in your church. Gather today.
The Spirit is upon us, so let us go out into the world. For we have been anointed to share the good news with everyone we meet, to bring freedom to those held captive, to bring hope to those who have been displaced, to tear down all structures of oppression, to declare that this is God's time. Amen. Hallelujah.